Imagine a planet of endless sand and scorching sun. A world where every day is a race for survival and every night a fearsome competition for resources. The infamous desert planet of Tatooine, located in a galaxy far, far away, is known for being an inhospitable wasteland. Yet the creatures that brave this unforgiving environment are truly fascinating and possess hidden intricacies that deserve to be studied further. So, for this entry into the archive, I'll be documenting this arid biosphere firsthand, analyzing the biology of these extreme life forms and seeing how their survival strategies compare to those present in Earth's deserts. So, join me in a landspeeder on this voyage across the desert as we uncover the mysteries of Tatooine. The planet of Tatooine orbits a rare binary star system, meaning it has two suns, with the smaller sun in a stable orbit around the larger one. On the surface of Tatooine, one can certainly feel the heat of both suns at all times, as can the animals that live here. Beginning our journey on the vast expanse known as the Dune Sea, life in this region is highly specialized to survive the merciless heat. Peering through my macro binoculars, I spot a group of woolly banthas. These hardy megafauna are the preferred method of transportation for the local Tusken populace, and a staple of Tatooine wildlife. A large furry animal might seem poorly suited for a hot desert environment, but we can find a desert life form with a similar strategy in the Earth camel. Camels are experts at keeping cool, in part through specialized shaggy fur that helps keep their body temperatures low to prevent excess moisture loss. So it's likely the banthas can endure the deserts of Tatooine thanks to similar adaptations. But beating the heat is one thing. To survive on Tatooine, the banthas must also find food and water. To discover the banthas' food source, one must dig underground. This is a black melon, a cactus-like species which, like many forms of cacti, is a precious source of water in this arid ecosystem. Once again, Earth camels supplement their bulk with a similar food source, grazing on cacti whenever they get the chance. While you or I might struggle to stomach plants like this, it's no trouble for desert specialists like the camel or the bantha. So, while the Dune Sea seems barren, the surprisingly dense network of underground vegetation means large creatures such as the bantha don't go hungry, if they know where to look. But it's not just the banthas who drink of the black melon. The Tusken clans, a group of mysterious, sapient lifeforms that call this unforgiving desert their home, also know all the ins and outs of the Dune Sea. I initially hoped to document some of their knowledge, but Tuskens are highly distrustful of off-worlders. They weren't interested in conversing without their masks, or even with them, so my questions about this planet's ecology go unanswered for now. Feeling my welcome is well past worn out, it's time I set off on my landspeeder once more and document the next life form of Tatooine. Heading through a narrow canyon, I spot a fearsome Massiff. And unfortunately for me, these mid-sized reptilian predators move in packs, coordinating in intricate groups to take down their prey. The Massiff pack structure is similar to those of spotted hyenas on Earth, with both species living in large factions that coordinate to apprehend animals far larger than themselves, and sharing in the spoils once the hunt is over. Fortunately for me, this pack, surprisingly, isn't wild, but are the domesticated allies of the same Tusken clan I spoke to before. As it turns out, domesticated Massiffs serve as loyal guard dogs across Tusken societies. Deciding to spend another night with the clan, I learn more about the Massiffs, like how their dorsal spines aren't just for defense, but also show the creature's age through their length. And although I'm still a little worried the Massiffs haven't stopped thinking about eating me, I'm excited to find the Tuskens are opening up to my questions. A Tusken storyteller I interview informs me that their people believe that thousands of years ago, Tatooine was covered in rainforest, and the Dune Sea itself was an ocean of flowing water. Such an extreme transformation might seem unlikely, but shells and other fossils found in the Dune Sea on a prior expedition corroborate this theory. The process by which fertile land becomes desert is called desertification, and it seems this process began on Tatooine around 25,000 years ago. Some claim the desertification of Tatooine was brought on by off-worlder activity, while others theorize it was a natural process caused by the planet's twin suns. In any case, it's something I'll have to keep in mind as I consider the lineage of the species that live here. The next morning, a commotion stirs through the camp. A trap has caught a nocturnal wart. Twisting out, the toad-like creature careens across the sand. Typically, worts are most active at night, where they feed on rodents like womp rats and anything else they can ambush with their shockingly long tongues. These tongues resemble those of Earth chameleons, which can also lash out with amazing speed at unsuspecting prey. Like the wart, the chameleon's tongue is stretchable to almost twice the animal's length, and is powered by spirally wound protein fibers, which can store energy like a stretched rubber band. Yet soon this predator will become prey. One quick blaster bolt, and it's all over. This worrt will help feed the clan and their massifs a little longer. To survive on Tatooine, one must take what one can get. Setting off towards the western reaches, I spot, in the distance, an intimidating creature rising up from the sand. This six-limbed feral beast is a Tatooine Sand Ape. Its target is a wild massif, which the giant sand ape makes short work of. This is not a creature one should mess with. While their name and muscular anatomy mirrors large primates like gorillas, the sand ape's ambush hunting strategy is actually much closer to a very different kind of life form. In the Sahara Desert, a slightly smaller predator swims under the sand. The sandfish is a type of reptile that buries itself within the dunes. Then, when prey gets close enough, it surfaces and snatches it up, just like the sand ape of Tatooine. And now that the sand ape has subdued the massif, it's time to head in the other direction, before it makes me its next meal. Cresting over a sand dune, I spot a herd of lethargic dewbacks. These thick-skinned reptiles are frequently used as mounts, both by travelers and those of a more sinister nature. Their name, however, comes from their seldom-glimpsed habit of licking the morning dew from their backs to stay hydrated. A desert animal drinking collected dew might sound miraculous, but Namib desert beetles, which I've discussed on this channel before, actually have a convergent survival strategy. On misty desert mornings, they stand on their heads and let the dew that collects on their backs drip down into their mouths. And with fog in the air today, these dewbacks likely have the same idea. On a world with twin suns, all water is precious. But there are far more dangerous creatures under the twin suns I've yet to document. Rancors are massive predators prized in the underground market for their fighting capabilities. Paying to study one specimen, I found they live up to their fearsome reputation. With their long arms, they seem somewhat unsteady on 2 feet, with a posture reminiscent of the fighting stance of a territorial grizzly bear. With their long claws and powerful brawn, grizzlies are perhaps the closest thing on Earth to a rancor. On their hind legs, these bears can tower over 7 feet, or 2 meters tall. But as imposing as grizzlies are, a full-grown rancor can easily reach 16 feet, or 5 meters tall, which puts into perspective just how dangerous these gigantic hulks of muscle really are. And since rancors are not native to Tatooine, their introduction has wreaked havoc on the local ecosystem. But much like grizzly bears, there's another side to the seemingly vicious rancor. My studies suggest young rancors actually imprint on whatever species they first interact with during an early period of development. Imprinting isn't unheard of in Earth's animal kingdom, and is present in young birds especially. But it might be a little surprising to see such a behavior in a beast as brutal as a rancor. Like most creatures, rancors are much more complicated than they first appear. That being said, there is one life form in particular that I've been apprehensive to study up close. In the pit of Carcoon dwells the carnivorous Sarlacc. Appearing as a giant mouth buried in the sand, local testimony indicates that under the surface, The Sarlacc's body is over 300 feet, or 100 meters long. A diagram from the field guide of the interplanetary naturalist Terrell Whitlatch gives us a more complete look at the Sarlacc's body underneath the sand. This diagram shows us that feeding tentacles extend from the creature's posterior end, drawing in nutrients from the surrounding sand like the roots of a plant. Indeed, the ever-confounding Sarlacc may be more plant than animal, but the Sarlacc still feeds on live prey that falls into its fanged mouth. While an organism relying on prey to fall directly into its domain might sound strange, one species on Earth does something quite similar. This pit belongs to an antlion, an insect-eating predator that digs steep holes in the sand that almost look like miniature Sarlacc pits. The antlion waits at the bottom of the trap for an ant to tumble down the slope, which the antlion then slowly devours. Curiously, there are similar rumors that the Sarlacc also digests its food over a long period of time, but the only way to determine whether or not this is true is to get a closer look. So, I'm lowering a flashlight-equipped camera inside the creature's gullet. This is a nerve-wracking operation, as the beast might awaken and attack the light at any moment. Navigating the camera down a stomach cavity, I find it's difficult to see anything. Turning on the high-powered beam, we've found the half-digested remains of an unlucky former meal. While gross, this discovery seems to confirm the theory of the Sarlacc's slow digestive system. Unfortunately, it seems the Sarlacc has had enough of our prodding and turns aggressive. Time to quickly pull the camera back up to the surface and leave this place forever. On Tatooine, one might assume the Sarlacc would be the top predator, but there is a single final lifeform on this planet large enough to eat Sarlaccs. While refueling at a town, I notice the sand begins to vibrate. When the ground shakes like this, every lifeform, from the tiny scurriers to the largest banthas, know it means trouble. One older bantha isn't quick enough. From the ground bursts an enormous predator, which vanishes just as quickly with its meal. That was a Krayt Dragon, the most elusive and deadly creature on Tatooine. The bones of juvenile Krayt Dragons can sometimes be glimpsed upon the dunes. But when Krayt Dragons reach their adult form, they're virtually invincible. This will be a very challenging species to study indeed. Reuniting with the Tusken clan from earlier, I agree to travel with them to the site of a Krayt Dragon cave. The Tuskens make a pilgrimage here regularly, as they've studied its digestive cycle for generations and feed the beast banthas to keep it satiated. From the depths of the cave, the creature emerges. This time, the dragon seems satisfied with its meal and retreats back under the sand. For now. According to the Tuskens, the Krayt Dragons have another terrifying habit when they feel threatened, projecting corrosive venom directly from their mouths, which causes their target to dissolve. While spitting venom might seem unusual, there are several species of spitting cobras that have a similar defense. When threatened, these snakes can contract muscles around their venom glands and launch venom from their needle-like fangs. And like the Krayt Dragon, some spitting cobras can launch their deadly venom more than 3 times the length of their bodies. Krayt Dragon venom, however, isn't true venom, but an acidic fluid that helps them digest their food. We're fortunate that the Krayt Dragon wasn't in a spitting mood today. Yet one way or another, eventually everything on Tatooine meets its end. To the south, an adult Krayt Dragon has died, and other species benefit from the resources its body leaves behind. The clan I'm traveling with is particularly effective at breaking down the different parts of these leviathans after they expire. But there is one body part in particular they seem to be searching for. A young hunter has found a rare Krayt Dragon pearl. These pearls are formed the same way as the pearls of Earth mollusks. The process begins when a small irritant like a grain of sand finds its way inside the lifeform. A crystallized substance known as nacre then forms around the irritant, and over time the layers build up and form a pearl. But it's an uncommon occurrence in Krayt Dragons, and hence finding this valuable pearl is a tremendous triumph for the clan. It's been an incredible trek across Tatooine. While all lifeforms here have to endure the same conditions, no two lifeforms have adapted to this planet's unique challenges in the same way. We've learned much about these survival strategies on our expedition, but with the twin suns high in the afternoon sky, the time has come at last to say goodbye to this unexpectedly teeming planet. As always, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this entry, please lend your support to help make videos like this possible by liking, subscribing, and hitting the notification icon to stay up to date on all things curious. See you in the next video.